This week on Wealth Track, avoiding an investment breakdown will help you navigate the economy, the markets, and reach your financial destination in good working order. Next on Consuelo Mack, Wealth Track.
For investors who think long term, strategy is only half the game. It takes creative moves. Merrill Lynch Investment Managers, innovative solutions for investors.
Additional funding provided by the Dreamin Foundation.
Hello and welcome to Wealth Track. I'm Consuelo Mack. If there were ever a case to be made for holding a well-diversified portfolio, it was made this week. A large and until recently successful hedge fund, Amaranth Advisors, reported it lost roughly $5 billion in 1 week, more than half of its assets, by making big bets on one commodity, the price of natural gas. The fund had made a bundle on energy futures in the last year and a half. The natural gas futures contracts hit a record $15 plus in December. They are now trading at less than a third of that at under $5 per million British thermal units. Amaranth was supposed to have hedged its bets. As the Wall Street Journal pointed out, the risk models employed by hedge funds use historic data. But the natural gas markets have been more volatile this year than in any year since 2001, making models less useful. I'll say, as one market veteran told the Journal, the market can stay irrational longer than you can stay solvent. Well, there have been other solvency challenges to market gamblers of late. The price of oil traded below $60 a barrel at one point this week, a steep drop from the nearly $80 reached just 2 months ago. Gold is more than $130 an ounce lower than it was at its high of $725 an ounce in May, although it has rebounded a bit over the last couple of months. And as anyone speculating in residential real estate knows, home sales and prices are showing ongoing weakness. Now, those softening home and falling commodity prices were among the reasons the Federal Reserve decided to leave short-term interest rates unchanged at 5.25% this week for the second meeting in a row. Bond investors were big beneficiaries of the signs of economic weakness. Bond prices have been rising, sending the yield on the 10-year Treasury note well below 5%. And stock investors haven't been doing badly either. The Dow has been approaching its all-time high of 11,722.98, hit on January 14th of 2000. Can you believe it has taken more than 6 years to get this close? Disasters to avoid and how to stay solvent are next on Consuelo Mack Wealth Track. Well, one of our missions on Wealth Track is to help you avoid the devastating kind of losses experienced by a big hedge fund recently. And joining me are a trio of investment professionals who have spent their careers helping clients make money and not lose it. One of Wall Street's most respected economists is among them. She is Nancy Lazar. She's co-founder of ISI Group, a highly regarded independent research firm. Nancy has been one of Institutional Investor's top-ranked economists for the past 5 years. And our next guest is one of the street's foremost market technicians. Technical analysts track historical prices for stocks and other asset classes to see what people are buying and selling. Louise Yamada, a four-time member of Institutional Investor's All-American Analyst List, heads her own firm, Louise Yamada Technical Research Advisors. And our third guest is followed by both professional investors and academics. Rob Arnott wears many hats. He is the editor of the Financial Analyst Journal, portfolio manager of multiple funds, including PIMCO's All Asset Fund, which is the first global fund to invest in alternative assets in addition to stocks, bonds, and cash. But the reason that he is here today is his latest creation. Rob, at his firm Research Affiliates, has invented a new type of investment which is catching on fast. It's called fundamental indexation, stock indexes and funds based on financial fundamentals, not stock market valuation. And we'll talk about that in just a minute. Great to have you all here. Nancy, I want to start with you, and I want to talk about the economy because there has been a lot of economic news of late recently. So where do we stand in the economy? I know you feel that it's slowing down. It is slowing down. How much and how concerned should we be?
We need the slowdown in the economy because inflationary pressures were starting to build. And a little pricing power may be okay, but if it gets out of control, then it would push the Fed to possibly tighten too much. But I think the Fed's done a pretty good job in cooling off the economy. I think growth is going to slow, and it's going to feel pretty tough, maybe for the retailers and the builders, maybe even CapEx. But on balance, a soft landing versus a hard landing.
And CapEx being capital spending.
Capital spending.
So business, and we saw that with the Philadelphia Fed index, surprising drop in manufacturing.
I'd call this a mid-cycle slowdown. And in a mid-cycle slowdown, you see a slowdown in pretty much every part of the economy, from employment to capital spending, and certainly this one, housing.
So why not a recession? Why do you think it's just going to be a slowdown?
Bottom line is the economy domestically and globally is fundamentally healthy. That is, corporate America is in great shape, unlike going into the 2001 recession. And so they really are the backbone of an economy. They are the guys that hire, they're the guys who spend. So you get a slowdown in employment, you get a slowdown in CapEx, but you don't actually get cuts because companies don't need to. And the global backdrop is actually pretty good also. I do think it will be a global slowdown, but countries from China to Europe, for example, are in pretty good shape. And so on balance, for a change, we actually have a pretty good cushion even outside of the United States.
Now, you mentioned housing. Employment, in one of the reports that you sent to your clients recently, roughly 20% of payroll growth over the last 3 years was housing related. So now what?
Well, housing activity and house price appreciation have already really faded. But housing employment has been pretty strong, actually. Companies haven't started to cut jobs within the housing industry. And I think that's going to come. It's not unusual in a mid-cycle slowdown for one part of the economy to get hit pretty hard. 1985, 86, it was oil, for example, that got hit hard. Today, it looks like it's going to be housing. But there are enough cushions around the economy, corporate balance sheets, as I mentioned in particular, that you don't actually have to see a decline in GDP, just a slowdown.
Now, do you think the Fed's has finished easing?
I think there have been a lot of signals.
Finished tightening, forgive me. Yeah, or we'll start easing, I should say. Yeah.
There are a lot of signals out there that the Fed should be done. One is the bond market. Bond yields are now clearly below the Fed funds rate, i.e. you have an inverted yield curve. Historically,
And an inverted yield curve for our viewers means that short-term rates are actually
higher than
long-term rates.
Exactly. That'd be one. Two, I think the weakness in housing, which is the most interest-sensitive part of the economy, is also telling the Fed, ouch, interest rates are high enough. If anything, interest rates may need to come down. And third, the inflation news, all of a sudden, pretty quickly, is looking like inflation is indeed starting to slow. So that the combination of those things really makes it easier for the Fed to stop tightening, which is where they are now. And as you move into 2007, yes, I do think the economy is going to be weak enough where the Fed actually can cut interest rates.
So Goldilocks economy, is that kind of what we're talking about, where nothing's moving, it's not going to slow down too much, but it's also not going to accelerate too much? Is that what we're in for? Or?
Say, for roughly the next year, the economy is going to slow down to about 2%. I would exactly call it a Goldilocks or a soft landing, not a hard landing. Allows interest rates to come down. Some companies are going to have a hard time, and so you are going to get layoffs. But at the end of the day, the economy doesn't have to go into a recession.
Stock market, you call this the pause that refreshes. You're actually pretty optimistic about the stock market. Why?
I do. Well, we've just gone through a period over the past couple of years where the economy has been very strong. The stock market's been okay, but it's not been great because it's had to deal with the higher interest rate environment. Historically, in these mid-cycle slowdowns, as we call them, the stock market does very, very well because even though earnings slow, the interest rate outlook and the inflation outlook are very, very positive. So net, historically, yes, stock market does very well in a mid-cycle slowdown. You have to be careful. You stay away from heavy industrial cyclicals, there are certain parts of the market that can do very well.
All right. Louise Yamada, you cover market patterns. What do you think about Nancy's feeling that she thinks the stock market's going to do pretty well?
I think, well, let me start with her mid-cycle slowdown.
Yes.
Because the technical equivalent of that would be what we call a contra-trend move, which is a temporary move in the opposite direction of the major trend. And we've had an incredible 5-6 years where the industrials, where the metals, where the energy, where the rails have really been a defined leadership. And they've taken a pause. Sequentially, each one of them is now correcting. And that is the point at which other sectors of the market come to the fore to fill in.
Mm-hmm.
Problem is that we don't have necessarily a defined leadership right now. We have a rotating leadership, which is going into a little bit into healthcare, a little bit into the financials, a little bit into consumer staples, and now it's moving a little bit into retail because with the energy prices down, the perception is that we may have a good holiday season. But it's very stock selective. We are finding that the sector work is not homogeneous, which means that not all the component stocks in any sector move together, that some look stronger than others. And that six-year period that we've had this incredible move, and although the Dow hasn't maybe only gone up 50% over this rally, the New York Stock Exchange is up 90%, the transport's 150%, so there are parts of the market that have done very well and now are due for a well-deserved rest. Also recognize that the New York Stock Exchange, the S&P 400, which is the mid-cap stock, the 600, and the transports have moved out to all-time highs over the past year, so they are way ahead of the Dow and the S&P.
So it sounds as if, I know that you have explained to me before, that it's a confusing market.
It's very confusing.
Which is probably makes a good case for indexing at this point. But yeah. I guess back to Nancy's point, so the leadership, the clear leadership that we saw for the last 4 years, there isn't any clear leadership now as the commodities have pulled back, as industrials have pulled back.
No, there's a rotation into other sectors,
right.
and the trading seems to follow the rotation. So you get into something fast and then the funds go out and it moves into something else.
So it's really a trader's market.
Yeah. I mean, conceptually, the idea would be that after a period of time, we come back to the old leaders, which may be the next part of the cycle. But right now, you're in the period where those former leaders, hopefully to be the future leaders, are taking a break.
So is there anything, given what you've just described, that individual investors, long-term investors should be doing at this point?
Well,
considering
we follow
previous
all
leaders.
The sectors from a performance perspective. And as sectors begin to underperform, we essentially move away from them because that's where you have the potential for price risk. So there would be some rotation has come to the fore with consumer staples. Now that's rotating into some of the consumer discretionary, which are some of the retail names.
Right.
Healthcare has gone through its from one sector within healthcare to another. But it hasn't been homogeneous, which goes to what Nancy said
right.
about selectivity. It's very clear from a technical perspective also.
You know, interest rates, the yields on 10-year Treasury notes are about 4.5%. And I know that Nancy really had a kind of a terrific piece of information that it's very difficult anywhere else in the world to find government debt that's over 4%. I mean, the U.S. is one of the unusual examples at this point.
4.5 sounds pretty low,
right.
But if you look historically, Italy is lower than we are, Greece is lower than we are, and it's like, maybe we are a high-yielding economy, and I think, which I don't think we deserve, quite frankly, but nonetheless, our bond yields are still historically high and also compared to other parts of the world, and I think they actually, though, could move lower. Historically, in mid-cycle slowdowns, along with the stock market doing well, or one of the reasons the stock market does well, is because bond yields do come down.
So I wanted to ask Louise about that, because we've had a 20-year decline in rates,
yes.
followed by a
mm-hmm.
little over 2 years of an uptick in rates
mm-hmm.
in here in the U.S. So now what? Are you seeing a major reversal of any trend, or what's your outlook?
Well, there's an interesting historical observation that the cycles in interest rates, and we're only moving into the eighth cycle in 200-plus years, have very definitely, when you move from falling rates to rising rates, it's a very slow, almost saucer-like process that can take 5, 10, 12 years.
Mm-hmm.
So we've been calling for about 5 years, an interest rate band or transitional trading range, if you will, between 3.5% and 5.5%, within which it's been extremely volatile, difficult to trade. But over the past year plus, you've gotten the slightly uptrending move. Yes, we think that rates certainly can come down from here, but all within this trading band. It's
okay.
All part of the transitional process to when and if inflationary pressures do, in fact, start taking over. Our threshold would be 5.5%. Once we see interest rates move through 5.5%, then we have a problem in
right.
terms of initiating the next rising rate cycle.
Rob Arnott, you knew we would get to you eventually. You have been predicting a low return environment for investors now for a couple of years. You think that we're in one, and low
yes.
returns mean how low?
I think we're looking at returns in the mid-single digits for mainstream stocks and bonds on a long-term basis the next 10 or 20 years. With bond yields at 5%, you aren't going to get 10% out of them.
Right.
With stock yields at 2%, the only way to get 10% out of that is 8% growth. Wall Street projects 8% growth, so we're fine, right? No, we're not.
No, we're not. So let's talk about what you have created, a new investment vehicle, essentially, a new way of indexing to enhance value so that we actually get higher values that we get from the normal stock market.
Right.
What is it, and tell us, you know, why you have been critical of the normal indexing, which is based on market capitalization.
Well, market capitalization is simply shares times price.
Right.
And what that means is that if you weight your index by market capitalization and the price doubles, you own twice as much. Why do you want to own twice as much after the stock's doubled? I'm not sure I understand that.
Buying high? Right.
Yeah. Market capitalization also means that any company that's trading above its eventual true fair value, which admittedly we can't know, is overweight. Every company below its true fair value is underweight. So most of your money is in overvalued stocks. Now, finance theory tells us that price exactly equals true fair value, so you're okay. But finance theory is only an approximation of the real world. Any practitioner would readily say, no, there's a true fair value. The market's price is the market's best guess at true fair value. Now, if you cap weight, you're overweighting every company that's overvalued, underweighting every company that's undervalued. If you break that link so that the weight in the portfolio and over or undervaluation are now severed, are independent of each other, you aren't going to wind up putting 60 or 80% of your money in overvalued companies.
So I was just going to say an example would be the S&P 500 in the year 2000 when 32% of the S&P 500 weight market value was in tech stocks.
That's exactly right. And what followed after that was a 2.5-year bear market, stocks falling in value by nearly half during the course of that bear market. And yet, most stocks went up in 2000. Most stocks went up in 2001. Most stocks went up in the first quarter of 2002. The bull market of the 1990s for most companies didn't end until April 2002.
Right. Wow. So fundamental indexation, what is it? How is that going to help us get better values in the undervalued stocks and participate in their growth?
The way fundamental indexing works is really simple. You weight the companies by their economic footprint. How big are they? If a company is 4% of the economy, make it 4% of the index, regardless of its market cap, regardless of its price, regardless of its valuation multiples. Now, if you do that, some big companies are overvalued, some are undervalued. We don't know which ones. Some little companies are overvalued, some are undervalued. But by weighting by company size, you break the link. You don't overweight the overvalued and underweight the undervalued. Now, we tested the idea going back 45 years in the U.S., and it added to over 200 basis points a year, over 2% a year, for over and above conventional indexes going back 44 years. Nomura tested it in all 23 countries in the developed world indexes. It added value in 23 out of 23.
Now, you know that the disclaimer we always say is past performance is no guarantee of future performance. What is the guarantee that your measurements and how you weight a company and what its, you know, economic footprint,
right,
what you look at sales and cash flow and...
We measure how big a company is as a percentage of the economy based on sales, profits, book value, and dividends. Four very simple measures. We equal weight the four measures, and that's our best rough approximation of the company's size. It is not crucial to get that weight exactly right. It is crucial to have that weight completely independent of whether the company is over or undervalued. So no acknowledgement of price, of market capitalization, of valuation multiples. It's a very simple idea.
All right. It's a very interesting idea. It's being put into practice now. There are indexes that are fundamental indexes now. There are, I know you manage a mutual fund at PIMCO that uses indexing and the fundamental indexing, and there are a lot of vehicles, and I guess, what, $4 billion is now being attracted to this this brand new concept that you've created.
It's gone from under $1 billion to not quite $5 billion just this year alone.
Right.
And so it's picked up $4 billion in assets just this year alone. PIMCO was the first institutional organization to embrace the idea. They have two funds that have been live for over a year. PowerShares has rolled out 12 exchange-traded funds based on the fundamental index, and it's growing.
So we're going to hear a lot more about this. All right. So what our viewers really want to know about is what you three think, where you think we should be investing. So we have at the end of every Wealth Track the one investment for a long-term portfolio. So Nancy Lazar, what is yours? You're looking at kind of diamonds in the rough.
Louise mentioned that the Dow has actually been an underperformer. Although it's up roughly 50%, it's underperformed. In previous mid-cycle slowdowns, large cap stocks typically outperform. And so we would focus on large cap stocks, diamonds. And as individual investors, you can participate in that, not buying all 30 of the Dow, but by buying diamonds.
All right. That's a traditional index fund. So Rob will have to show Nancy at some point kind of the equivalent in the fundamental indexing. Is there an equivalent yet available for a fundamental indexing of the Dow?
Not of the Dow.
All right.
Just market sectors, large companies, small companies, international.
All right. But in the meantime, if you want to invest in the Dow, that's a good way to do it. Louise, what is your choice for one investment for a long-term portfolio?
Well, I'm going to choose a Dow stock because, in fact, we are in a contra-trend move and the large-cap stocks are outperforming the old small-cap leaders, and I would pick AT&T for the simple reason that it has just emerged from a four-year base, and we love to find stocks that are just initiating their uptrends. And the stock broke out through $25, and I think it has higher potential over time.
And AT&T, that is an old name that has had many, many transformations.
Exactly.
At any rate. So it's back in your portfolio.
Back to being the mother.
You hope. Rob Arnott, we have a rule in Wealth Track that you cannot recommend any of the funds that you yourself are investing, even though I know you would
do
that.
I understand that.
So what would you have us invest in?
Well, I think every one of your viewers knows what kinds of stocks I would recommend. And so let me shift focus. And those who want a counterbalance to their equity investments, I think developing local market debt is fascinating. What is it? It's bonds that are non-sovereign debt within emerging economies denominated in the local currency. It's a non-dollar play. It's a premium yield. And it's a diversification away from mainstream stocks to give you a better risk-controlled and more broadly diversified portfolio.
All right. Very interesting. From all of you, thank you so much. Nancy Lazar, Louise Yamada, Rob Arnott, it is a treat to have you all here on Wealth Track.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, at the conclusion of every Wealth Track, we give you one suggestion to help you build or protect your wealth. And this week's was triggered by the huge losses suffered by hedge fund Amaranth Advisors and a report from Morningstar about the closing of what the ratings firm called an awful fund. A large-cap growth fund that had underperformed 96% of its peers for 10 years. So those events raise the question, when should you get out of a fund that you own? If you are a regular Wealth Track viewer, you know that we choose guests with terrific long-term track records. So the chances are, as long as they or their team are running their funds, you should never sell them. So this week's action point, consider selling a mutual fund when the following happens. The manager you know and trust leaves the fund. If the manager didn't have a team in place for several years, you could be facing an unknown quantity. A change in strategy at a fund. Suddenly a large cap fund goes after mid cap companies to chase better performance. 2 years or more of double digit losses. Now even the best fund managers have down years. Legg Mason's Bill Miller had three at the start of the decade, but two of them were single digit losses, and in two he beat the market and his category. Now, the flip side is consider selling if a fund has phenomenal performance. The 100% gains of some tech funds in 1999 were an anomaly, so just take the money and run. Now, a fund's expenses go up. If a fund is successful, its expenses should be decreasing, not increasing. And finally, if you are uncomfortable with the fund, it's redundant, or it's no longer fitting your needs, there are some funds and managers that never go out of style. And obviously, the last one that I said, I got a little confused here. is that you should definitely just sell if the fund no longer meets your styles. But there are fund managers that never go out of style, and we're going to continue to bring those to you on WealthTrack. Two of them will join us here next week to scour the globe for opportunities. Value investor David Winters has brought his excellent track record to his new Wintergreen Fund. And Kathleen Gaffney has added her value for years to the highly regarded Loomis Sayles Bond Fund. They're going to be joined by an art market appraiser and auctioneer, Paul Provost of Christie's. In the meantime, we've got two brief announcements for you. We are now webcasting WealthTrack, so if you missed any part of this program or want to see it again, you can go to our website, WealthTrack.com, next week, and you can watch it online. And we also want to welcome the Bluegrass State to the WealthTrack family. Kentucky viewers can now watch us on KET2, and we are very glad to have you aboard. And don't forget, always make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
For investors who think long term, strategy is only half the game. It takes creative moves. Merrill Lynch Investment Managers, innovative solutions for investors.
Additional funding provided by the Dreamin Foundation.